A very warm welcome and good morning to one and all present here. Today, I stand here in front of you with all sorts of mixed emotions streaming through my mind, as now we have come to the end of the Eklavya Summer Internship 2014. I still can't stand the fact that this internship has finally come to its conclusion. Being habitual of getting nostalgic every now and then, flashback to the time when I came here, from the very first day my learnings and lessons started. And now, in the end of it, I can proudly say that this internship has given me some pivotal characteristics that I'll carry on for the whole of my life. And these characteristics will help me have intense desires to attempt, achieve, conquer, maybe fail sometimes, but still stand back and fight till the end. I'm sure you all must be agreeing with me. IIT Bombay has given us all more than what we expected. We all have got our own achievements, guides, and pals for life. I'm Ayushi Gaur, intern under Ek Shiksha team, is going to be your host for the following 2 days. Now, not wasting much of the time, let us start with what we are here for. Let me introduce you to the first group, the Fundamental Research Group. The Fundamental Research Group is managed by Mr. Nagesh Karmali. Let me call the first team, Data Analytics Workbench for Educational Data, mentored by Mrs. Shugla Nag, Ms. Firuza Ebra, and Mr. Nagesh Karmali. EDX is a massive online course, MOOC destination site, and online learning platform that is open source. EDX platform generates tremendous amounts of data related to students, instructors, staff, and courses. Analysis of EDX data enables us to answer the fundamental question about learning nature of students. Now I'd like to request the team to come up and proceed with their presentation.
Good morning, everyone. I'm really happy to be starting off the presentation today with the Fundamental Research Group presentation on Data Analytics Workbench for Educational Data. Before we go ahead, let's start with the introduction. As we all know, EDX is an open source MOOC platform. Unlike Coursera and Udacity, other such MOOC platforms, it's open source. We all know that it generates tremendous amounts of data. Since there are lots of logs being generated, there's a lot of back-end stuff going on. What we were wondering the first time when we came for this project was that how tremendous is this data? Is this data actually enough to call it a big data project? So let's go ahead. So what we did was some simple number crunching when we actually started off our project. This simple number crunching was actually based on the test which all of us interns had at around 14th May. We actually received this data, so we were actually able to do some computations on it. There were around 80 students, as you can see, 2 to 3 hours of a test, 120 questions, 1.5 GB. All this overall amounted to around 0.02 GB of data per student. So then what we did was we checked that actually for an EDX course, on average, how many students generally participate. And what we were surprised to find was that it's around 40,000 students. So when we actually started calculating now, what we saw was that even if we take this number down to 2 to 3 hours per week, and we found that they also interact with many more things. Since in the test, we only interacted with problems, we would end up with a total of around 750 GB per week per course. And if you take this for a 3-month course, we can all see how we can see clearly see that it is at the level of big data. So let's get to the main objective of our project, basically a data analytics workbench for educational data. When we got this project, the main aim of our project was actually to create a workbench such that we receive a lot of EDX logs, a lot of data. We get a complete process by which this workbench will automatically load this data. And it'll keep it ready so that it can be analyzed by not only staff or other people, but also by researchers who can use it to get important results. And apart from that, also we went a step ahead and actually visualized the data so that it can actually provide a first useful user interface so that people can actually see what is going on in the system. Next comes the tools for big data. I'm not going to spend so much time here. Basically, we've listed the tools which we've used both for the big data technologies as well as the front-end technologies which we actually use to visualize and show how our platform is working.
So the EDX platform delivers the two kinds of the data. One is the log data and another is the database data. And the EDX use the MySQL platform to store its relational tables and the MongoDB for the NoSQL database. And all the date times are stored in the UTC format. The event tracking data contains the all amount of the log data that the student generates when it interacts with the LMS platform. And these are the kinds of events in which we can categorize the log events. The database data can be divided into these 8 types, in which around 7 are in the SQL table formats, and the forum data is stored into the MongoDB database. And these is the basically the SQL mind map of the tables. We categorize all the useful tables into the 3 ways, like certificate data contains the generated certificate information, and the user data contains the student demographics data, and the courseware progress data contains the progress of the student in a particular course. This is the ETL part of the data analytics system. Like first we extract the system, then we transform the data, and then we load it into the SGFS.
So the first step of the ETL platform was actually to provide a GUI so that not only some programmer or actually a person who knows the system internals can use it, but also any end user who wants to actually start working on his research can directly start using it. That's why our first step was actually to provide a ETL GUI where you have to just provide simple options such as what type of data are we using and the basic path to your data. The GUI automatically then starts working according to a Django backend, which we'll come to later. The next step of the ETL can be shown by this block diagram, which is our data organizer. What happens once we receive the input to our data? As you can see, there are different types of inputs over here. It's sent into our data organizer, which sends it, which first segregates the data according to its different types. And then according, like here we are talking about EDX data packages. There are 2 formats of data. One is EDX data packages, and the second is locally generated data. So the EDX data package data is already provided in a pretty easy to use format. What we have to do is just segregate the data into its different types, prepare it into TSV formats so that it can be directly uploaded onto HDFS so that it's ready for the next loading and transforming phases. The next part, which is the locally generated data, was a little more difficult to handle since it has not been properly initially organized. What we had to do was not only do a recursive search and segregate the data, but also handle source files, which was SQL source files, which were handled using a big data tool known as Scoop, which directly uploads it onto HDFS. On the other hand, Mongo data had to be queried into first a Mongo database table, converted into TSV format so that it is again ready for loading and transforming. And finally, the local log data was again segregated and arranged into a HDFS. Finally comes the step 3 of the data, which is loading the data. For loading the data for the EDX data packages, for the SQL files, at least we were directly able to upload it onto the Hive tables, and same for the locally generated SQL tables, since they followed the same format exactly. However, the biggest problem we faced were for logs. The reason being that there are around 5 to 10 different types of events, and each of these events have a number of sub-events, because of which, if we would have actually concatenated all the possible logs into one table, it would have come up to more than 50 or 60 columns. For this reason, what we did was that we arranged it according to the different events which are given here. As you can see, there are common events, student interaction events, instructor events, and it all had to be organized according to the type of event it was. All this was done using serializers such as JSON tuple. Apart from that, it also had we also required a getJSON object, and a number of such tools were required. For the MongoDB part, as I had explained earlier, what we had to do, this flowchart simply explains how it works. What happens is, first is the, as I had explained, the data organizer organizes the data. After that, it is uploaded onto your Mongo database. Once it is uploaded onto the Mongo database, a PyMongo connector was used in order to actually query this data, obtain the useful part, because there are a lot of fields which are actually not required right now. We obtained the useful part and provided it into CSV or TSV format, which can be directly uploaded into Hive tables. And finally, this is all the blocks which we discussed until now. All of them have been connected together. As you can see, it starts with the GUI. It goes into the data organizer. The data organizer uploads it into HDFS. It is then, after initial loading, it has to be pre-processed. A lot of cleaning has to be done internally. And finally, it is sent into one common platform of Hive, which can be queried using Hive or Shark, which again we will discuss later. Now starts the visualization part, which Prashant will handle.
For the data visualization part, we use the D3 and the dimple.js JavaScript library. And these are basically the 2 JavaScript libraries, and the dimple is based on the D3 itself. And with the first, what we did, that the Hive output of the Hive queries is transferred into the TSV and the CSV files, Then these files are used for plotting the graphs. These are some of the queries that we have implemented on the summer intern test data. The data was around 1.4 GB and the 37 queries are formed and the implemented. Some of the important ones are mentioned below. We categorize all the queries into four parts: the student analytics, enrollment analytics, problem analytics, and the questionnaire analytics.
So I will tell you some of the queries we implemented. One of the graphs, this graph shows the age distribution, that is the age distribution of the users who have registered for a particular course. Now the second category which we categorized our analytics was the course analytics. In course analytics, one of the graphs was active users per day, that is the number of users active in per day in a particular course. The next one was video analytics. Video analytics has these queries, and one of the examples is number of users who use transcript for a video. This is basically the number of users who used subtitles to understand the video in a particular course. Then we have is problem analytics. In problem analytics, we have this graph. This is the response time of students solving quiz questions by course, and this is a stacked bar chart. And each stack shows a question and the response time according to the question for a particular user. Next is the enrollment analytics, and this is a world map. This world map shows the number of users registered for a particular course from different countries. Then we have basic statistics. In basic statistics, this is one of the most important graphs because it will be used further for predictions and all. And this graph shows the sequence followed by different users for completing a course or learning a course. And this graph shows different nodes like enrollment, navigation, and problem. These are different types of events, and according to the sequence which different users follow, the intensity of the arrow shows how many users have gone through that path. And I'll tell you some more charts. This is the correct incorrect responses for problems. This is basically the data the quiz data which we gave. Each question shows the correct and incorrect responses for a problem for a particular quiz.
Since we have done the visualization using the D3 part, so we tried it using the Google charts. It provides you with a large number of dynamic charts and more complex one, where you can have the flexibilities of choosing what you want on the x-axis, y-axis, and the labels for that. So Google charts uses the three JavaScript libraries. One is the JS API visualization library and the library for chart itself. So then you to proceed with the charts, you have to prepare the data in the form of data tables and views, and then you can customize it, instantiate it, and then you can draw the charts. You have the two functions, chart.draw and draw charts, to draw the charts. And then you have the three ways to populate the data. Either you can populate it manually, or the CSV or the TSV file that we got from the as output of the Hive queries, and the other one is from the Google spreadsheets, and then we can query it also. This is the interface that we developed to visualize using the Google charts. So this is the home page, and then next here you can, as you can see, that you can select the data set and the chart type. You can select the data set and the chart type, and then you can select whether you want to query or not. And then once you submit, you'll be directed to the other page. As you can see that we tried two kinds of data sets. One was the air passengers, which was the test data set, and the response time data set, which was the data set that the data that we got from the quiz that was conducted in the beginning of this intern. So without querying, the bubble chart for the response time data set, as you can see above, and the other one with querying, you're getting this way.
So we have done the querying part using Google charts, and we have loaded the data. Now for querying the data, to provide the user with an interface where he can query by himself and see the output, we have done it using Django. Django is used to integrate both data loading and data visualization in a web application. It is a Python-based web framework. It can easily execute Python queries, R and Hive queries as well. It is also capable of queuing the processes. That is, if a process takes a large amount of time, we can put it in a queue, and when the previous process has done its execution completely, next process can start. This shows the overall data loading part. Okay, in this, first of all, we are going to get the input from the user, and then the workers of the queue. That is, we have used a Redis RQ for this purpose. Workers will put it in a queue and it'll check that whether the queue is free or not. Depending on whether the queue is free, further processing are made. If queue is free, it'll start working. Like as previously it has been explained, it'll load the data. But if the queue is not free, after some time gap, it'll again check whether the queue is free or not. We have data visualization part. On getting the input arguments, first of all, Django will check whether the arguments are correct or not. And after that, it'll see that which query is to be run for now. When it decides that the input we have got is correct, and the function that we have to call to generate the graph, two processes simultaneously run. First one is querying, like it queries from the database, it generates the CSV or the TSV file, and the other part which generates a template, and it combines both of these parts, like CSV file and the template part, to give the final output. Next one is the overall processing, that is, first of all, it decides whether it is data visualization or data loading, and then completes it all. This is just a screenshot that we have generated a graph depending on student mark statistics. This is the right hand side. You can see the input form where user can choose what for which course he want to enter in, and the course has started when, and what are the queries. Like in the last drop down, he can choose for which query he wants to check for. This is the message that that gets shown when there is no data for the particular query.
Optimization part. What we have done that is that we use the Shark and Spark. It reduces the query time and it is very much as compared to the Hive and the Shark part. Like Hive takes the 48.9 seconds around for this particular query, and the Shark takes only 9 seconds. And for the simple query, the Shark takes the 3 seconds and the Hive takes the 21 seconds. So it is considerably reduces the time. These are the results that we have got, that the technologies used that he has shown, that we have used the big data tools and the technologies, and for the front end part we have used the Django and the D3, Dimple and the Google Charts. And he has already explained the architecture of our system. We have implemented it on a single node cluster as well as the multi-node cluster, and the ETL automator script, what the script does is that it automates whole the data loading process and the data visualization process, and all in one user interface for as well as the admin purpose and as well as for the end user like teachers and professors. These are some of the future works that we have decided. Sequential data mining to find the sequence in which a student learned, so that you can predict the student behavior, and the detecting undesirable student behaviors, like if someone is giving answers in a quiz for in a very short duration, or if he gave all the answers, then there must be some sort of cheating, or we can decide on after predicting about the data. Latent knowledge estimation is about estimating the knowledge pattern of the students, and detecting possibility of student dropouts, like if some students is watching a video for a very short duration and he's not interested in the course, then after data analysis part we can drive such situations. And using the MongoDB data of the EDX part, the MongoDB is basically a NoSQL database. It contains the forum data and the courseware related data, so we can use that data and use the natural language processing to find out that which students are active on the platform on forum data as well as in the course. And integrating the Django front end with the multi-node cluster, and we have already set up a multi-node cluster, and we want the Django front end work for the whole cluster. This is our team, we are the 5 members. And
so you have used standalone data generated during the quizzes that were taken?
Yeah.
Any attempt has been made to integrate it with the actual IIT Bombay X EDX?
Okay. So actually what we found out, right, the first thing which we did was found out ki which types of data are we going to get as input. IIT Bombay X and EDX data, we spoke to Sukla ma'am. She told us that she gave us, in fact, the way the data is going to be generated internally in IIT Bombay X. And a second source of data would have also been Amazon data packages, which are being EDX data packages downloaded from the Amazon EC2 server. There are two forms of data input, as I had discussed earlier. So for the Amazon data packages, I had shown you that block diagram earlier. And for the locally generated data, which I had spoken about IIT Bombay X specifically, in that case, we've created that system, which is a little more complex. It doesn't, because initially the Amazon provides the data in a much more parsed format. But IIT Bombay X data is in a form of SQL dumps, MongoDB dumps, which have to actually be initially transformed and parsed by us.
I don't understand. There are thousands of courses that are running on EDX, correct?
Yeah.
Lot of big data is being generated.
Yeah.
Okay. What analysis does EDX itself provide on its data?
EDX itself provides very simple analysis right now. It provides you your basic statistics, like I had shown you, which we are also providing. It provides you basic demographic data, such as the ratio of females and males. It provides you basic data about degree distributions. Basically, all the data it provides only comes from the SQL tables. There's no data which they provide from their logs. They don't generate any kind of visualization or analytics from their logs. Almost all their, at least until now, all the data analytics which is being performed is only performed on their SQL data. They are improving their framework right now, but it's still going to take a long time.
Okay. So the EDX data is available where?
Basically, as I explained, there are two types of data. One is your locally generated data, which is your blended MOOCs data. Regular EDX provides most of their data on the form of Amazon EC2. From Amazon EC2 servers which they have online, you can download their data. But that they only provide to data czars, which are representatives to other colleges. Otherwise, any college which is themselves hosting EDX, such as IIT Bombay will now be hosting, MIT has been hosting, they have their own locally generated data, which is actually a more important source of data analysis.
Sorry, locally generated data talks about quiz. These are MySQL tables. This is not large data.
No, in fact, correct. Locally generated data is much larger, because locally generated data also has your logs. Locally generated data also has your MySQL tables.
Then why? Then if that data is large, what is the additional data that is there in your Amazon, whatever you talked about?
Amazon data is basically like the international EDX platform, which is there, in which all the people participate, means from international, from different countries.
We are only concerned on EDX. Mm. Okay, what has Amazon got to do with EDX?
Like for your own data which you generate, for your own courses, for everything which is of your own, for that, it directly connects with your own locally generated data. Amazon only provides that data which is generated in other courses. In their own courses, they are providing data.
Why do I analyze that?
It's optional. That's why we provided an option for both. If there's
why?
Any research.
Why?
Because there are researchers who may be interested in analyzing data as well.
Forget that. You may have a fundamental research group. I am a very practical person. I don't do research. Okay. So I should only integrate the portion of your software, which what you call as local data.
Yeah.
For that, I don't have to beg anybody.
No, you don't have to. You get the data directly from the
table.
MOOC table.
Okay.
It's got everything. It's got logs also. It's got MongoDB dumps also. It's got everything which even
but
the EDX
logs
data
are in MySQL, right?
No, they're in JSON format. They have to be cleaned, they have to be transformed. There's a lot of processing which has to be done.
Which you have done already.
Which we've done it. It's all integrated into an end system and it's there in the lab. We've integrated everything and ready.
So my other question was, okay, there was a testing done.
Yeah.
Okay. On IIT Bombay, two phases.
Yeah.
Okay. Why did you not attempt to integrate your stuff during the testing phase so that at least my...
Because, sir, the testing phase was when he just came in here, that time the test had happened.
No, sorry. Testing just happened 2 weeks back.
We were not made aware.
We have a product to release in July 27. That product release needs some testing. Okay.
We were not
testing
made
probably
aware.
Happening right now as we speak. Okay.
Okay. We were not aware of that.
The second thing I need to know is, how do I know you have covered all types of data?
As I said, if you had seen in our future goals, we've missed out just one type of data, that too only for the Amazon server data, which is, again, as
Amazon,
I said,
Amazon
if
server,
you don't need
as far as I know, IIT Bombay has got, I don't know whether, if I release the product, will some data go into Amazon?
No, it won't. It'll be generated locally.
Okay, what are the challenges?
The challenges which we faced in the process, the first challenge was that there are two types of data. Again, I won't go into that specifics, but more importantly, the most difficult challenge we faced, as I had explained earlier, the logs which we had, because there were around 5 to 8 different types of categories of logs, and each of those categories have different types of events. As such, you can say subcategories. And if I would have actually taken, generally what the notion would be that for all your logs, you put everything into one table and then you do querying on that. But the problem we faced was that if we would have put everything into one table, we would have come up with a table which has more than 50 or 60 columns, and for each different log, around 20 to 25 of those columns would have remained null. So instead of doing that, what we did was that we segregated each of these tables into different categories so that we have maximum amount of data being stored instead of null values being stored in most of the database. That was one of the main challenges. Secondly was the MongoDB data. The MongoDB data does not come in any kind of TSV or CSV format. It is a NoSQL format, as we all know. So what we had to do was we had to actually apply a Python Mongo connector and query out the important part of the data, because it has all logs and all dumps into it, out of which we only require certain things like which was the quiz number, which week was that quiz held in, for what was the due date, what was the start date of that quiz. We had to actually remove that information and put it into useful tables. So we had to actually, what we did, our end product was actually, in case of MongoDB, was that we put it into a TSV format which can be directly loaded onto Hive.
Thanks.